It was a surprise for us, and we feel extremely grateful to be here, and also as a participants, not only to present our social business, but also to hear. And I feel extremely intimidated, because after those two rich and interesting, innovative presentations, and it seems to be that you are running the extremely successful business, social businesses, we feel a little bit small. But I think that it will be the contrast, but it will be also interesting for those who are thinking about starting a social business or creating a startup in this social business field, because I will try to show how we can do things when we are starting from nothing. We feel different because small. We feel we are also different because we are working with a different target group. And the specificity of the target group is that we are working with ex-drug addicts, ex-prisoners, ex-homeless people, and it makes a difference. From what I understood from Bordeaux-Herzegovina, you are working with women who are motivated to work. Our target group, we need not only to give them a chance, to give a training on the work, to give a work, but we need also to go, take them, motivate them to work, and it makes things extremely complicated, and I will try to explain why and how we are doing it. And of course, it has an impact on our business part of social business, and this will also, I will try to explain. So our difference is also because we are linked to the municipality of Vilnius. We were established in a private and public partnership, so it's also a difference that I will try to explain later. Definitely we are an NGO, and in Lithuania it's possible for an NGO to run a commercial business, so we have never thought to become a private company. We don't need to have a foundation and then to create just a pure business company. We can combine both and be an NGO and run a commercial activity, so there is no dialectic between the profit and non-profit per se, per excellency. An NGO, it's a non-profit organization. And at the end, for this introduction, I would like to say that it's very interesting to hear about successful social business examples, and very interesting to see the whole stories, but all, as a professional, for me, it's always interesting to understand how they did it. Go into technicalities, how they raised the funds, who were their partners, how they're working, how it's organized their work day to day. As we are a small company, I will try just to show you and to explain, and I hope that you will have quite very practical and technical questions afterwards. So I would like the technical assistance we have a small movie about us, and you will understand the context, and then I will continue to present our case. Thank you.
What does a human need to feel happy? Of course, the answer depends on who the question is given to. One does not feel happy even if embracing the whole world, while the other is satisfied with a trifle. Just another chance.
Čia išmokau aš sąžiningumą, čia aš išmokau, man atrodo, atvirai kalbėti apie viską.
Darius and Linas are former drug addicts. They and many other young people walking on the edge received a helping hand to overcome the addiction and get back to the society from a unique project they took part in.
Aš pradėjau mylėti savo darbą.
Found my job. I like talking with our visitors. I love our teammates, as I know I can be honest and frank with them. And there is no need to hide any inner problems I suffer from. Of course, I know I must distinguish my feelings among other people, as not everyone is able to understand the addiction we are living with. But there, I feel I have got a perfect chance.
After finishing their preparatory courses, former drug addicts may work, and they work in the salad restaurant, Mano Guru, since 2004, inviting its visitors to the heart of Lithuanian capital. the project My Guru entails either a social integration of individuals suffering from dependency diseases or their rehabilitation. As many as 70% of the My Guru employees are people who suffered from addiction to psychotropic substances. Participation in the project and employment in a healthy food restaurant encourages former addicts to acquire new skills, experience, and to overcome fear of themselves and their past lives.
They do not have any skills, so they cannot find jobs. Moreover, they are reluctant to study as they haven't graduated from secondary school. They need to start from scratch, and the start means the lack of self-confidence.
My Guru is a project having no analogs in Lithuania. For many addicts, it not only helped to overcome the dependency and get back to the labor market, but also made our society better perceive integration problems former addicts are facing with. My Guru is an excellent example of cooperation between business and local authorities, public organizations, health education institutions, which has encouraged significant changes in the processes of social integration improvement within the country. My Guru altered a Lithuanian understanding about what a social business entity is, that such a business can be not only a place for the rehabilitation of former addicts, but yield profit as well. In 2009, My Guru received an award of the most hospitable restaurant in Vilnius.
Thank you. Okay, so my presentation will be separated into parts and into few parts, and I will talk a lot about ex-drug addicts, about our target group, their needs, because in fact, it's a target group when you need really to tailor your service to the target group. You can, it cannot be any person coming from the street. You have really to take into account all the specificities of the target group in order to develop a good tool for integration. So the first thing it was to see from where is coming our target group. We are taking people who are not dependent anymore, so they are coming from the rehabilitation communities. If you know the way that the ex-drug addicts are usually taking is they are going out of the community to the closed communities, which we are calling rehabilitation centers, and they are passing there from six to nine months or 1 year, and they are learning to live without addictions. The problem is that it's okay, it works, and it's organized like that in all the world. But unfortunately, once those persons are coming back to the town after have been for 1 year in a closed communities, they have nothing. They have no skill. They have some skills, but they have still no social skills. They need a job. They need a place to live. They need new friends. They need a lot of things that they don't have. So they are falling like that into the town, without having all these necessarily things to be integrated, and usually they're unfortunately reusing drugs because they are still in the same, they still have the same familial problems, they still have the same friends. So we identified that after this rehabilitation stage, there is a need for a reintegration stage, and it should be a compulsory step to end the rehabilitation. To have this reintegration phase, and this reintegration phase cannot be only a training. It should be really done, effectuated on a workplace, in an enterprise. And this is the only way to succeed, really, for those persons to be further integrated into the labor market and able to work. So we have developed this theoretical model of reintegration, of reinsertion after the rehabilitation. We have working 11 years already, and we have implemented six European Social Funds projects. The projects, that means a lot. And those projects permitted us to create innovative model of the integration into the labor market of socially excluded persons, people. So the core element of Mano Guru model is the importance of a social reintegration phase, as I told you, coming after the social and psychological rehabilitation in a closed community. So the integration, it's the aim of the integration, it's really to help those persons to come back and to reintegrate the society through work. This reintegration phase, as I already mentioned, should be definitely integrated into the whole process of this rehabilitation. It should be inherent and compulsory part of that overall of psychological or social rehabilitation process. It's, of course, interconnected with the cure and the rehabilitation with the return to a meaningful life. So we have these steps, which for us, it's without those connected steps, you cannot succeed. It's the desintoxication, it's the rehabilitation in a closed community, and it's an integration in a social enterprise on a workplace. So it's, for us, it should be an interrupted and continuous process. And it seems maybe evident, but things are not happening like that in Lithuania. And we were really the first one who was stressing that there is a need for reintegration phase after the rehabilitation. So as you see, this is these are our main steps, and what was important for us is to make understand the public authorities, municipalities who are funding rehabilitations, that they need to fund also reintegration as a separate stage, and this lobbying was quite complicated, and we still don't have written those things in our policies or implement policies, implementation plans, action plans, but still people started to understand more and more the need of organized rehabilitation as process through those steps. And of course we were inspired by the transnational experience. We don't have cooperatives like in Italy, and it was the first thing that we discovered is how works the cooperatives in Italy. I think that it still not exists in Latvia, and as I understood, we are all these three countries in European Union, it's Lithuania, Latvia and Bulgaria, who don't have this cooperative, social cooperatives. Those cooperatives differ, the mode of functioning differs from country to country, but the general idea is implemented for the first time in Italy, in France, and in Greece. We have visited some rehabilitation and reintegration enterprises in centers in Greece, for example, and it's exactly how it is organized. We are trying now to implement it in Lithuania. People are coming from detoxification to rehabilitation. The rehabilitation phase is short, about 6 months, and then people are coming back to town to reintegration centers where they can have accommodation, where they can acquisition and rebuilding of professional skills is provided. They have help as consultation, information, and they are trained at a workplace. They can have a first work, first chance, and with this professional experience, they can go to the labor market later and have a normal job. And of course, there is very important is to accompany these people once they are back to town. It's important them to participate to support groups and or other anonymous groups. So that for the transnational experience. And so coming back to the reintegration model, we think that and those for me are also the criteria for the social enterprise which would like to work in that field, is that you are organizing things in order to make the integration reintegration integral, continuous. It should be in a non-protected environment, that means not in a closed community. It should be specifically organized for that. And for me, that means that it cannot be done on a big scale in a just normal enterprise. It should be specifically organized. That for that, it cannot be done in a just business company, in any restaurant. It should be done in a social company, in a social business, in a social restaurant. And what is important, another criteria is that on top of the professional skills, you need to provide other skills. So the self-permitting, the self-education, and this is very important, and the personal development of your target group and or project participants, and also providing the professional working skills. And that makes the process very complicated, because it asks you for extra costs. For those you need for, it's, you are not only need mentors to train the target group to work as, for us, for example, bartender, cook, or server, but you also need to provide social worker consultations, psychologist consultations. You need also to provide some leisure activities, accommodation, and a lot of things. And that, it's tricky for the business, because it depends extreme, it comes to be extremely expensive. So that means that we have to combine this business and social goals of our enterprise, and it becomes complicated. And the only way to have a bigger target group, a bigger number of project participants, for example, 6 at one moment or 12 at one moment, it's to implement projects which are financed by municipality or by European Social Fund. So at the end, once we started, we spent 2 or 3 years, we saw that we are really developing an innovative model of social enterprise, which does not exist in Lithuania. The only social enterprise that you have in Lithuania is the enterprises that are funded by the state. They are given a subvention if some normal enterprises are employing some, for example, usually it's handicapped persons, but it's something else. So for the first time, we just realized that we are developing something new, which does not exist. And this new thing, it was that you really, on the equal, we were talking about balance. So for us, balance is essential also and crucial. When you have business goals and social goals, and both of them are equally important. There is no one goal which is more important or another one. You have those two goals, and you have to follow them. So the Mano Guru social enterprise model, we have persons who are coming from the rehabilitations. Usually those are also NGOs. Then they are going to the social project. The social project is financed till now by ESF. We don't know how it will be when it will be no ESF anymore or less ESF for the next programming period. So the persons are coming from rehabilitation to the social project. They are trained. We are working with them from 6 months to 1 year. And after that, they are, thanks to the partnership, we have the restaurant, they are going to work in the restaurant, they are acquiring this professional experience, we are writing them a real CV, and with that they can go to the private sector and to the labor market, and we are helping them to find a job. So this is the way how the way that our project participants should do to go to the final station. It's the be integrated in the labor market and to be able to be employable, normally employable in any other restaurant. So our objectives, as I told, it's a balance between business objectives and social objectives. And of course, the business objectives are always the same, is to provide services to the market and to be able each day to provide services to the market. Even if your target group is not there, sick, unable to do things, not willing, not motivated, it's not the right day, you have anyway your obligations, and you have to be able to provide the services. And this is challenging. It's also a necessity to keep competitiveness, because without being a good service provider, you will never be financially sustainable. And having working for years in this field, I have seen so much in all the Europe social enterprises which are delivering bad services, which are producing goods not interesting and that nobody wants to buy, and this is not the aim. The aim is not to ask for compassion, but the aim is to provide a good, really good service. So what is interesting is that people are coming to the restaurant and sometimes they don't know that it's a social business. So they are leaving the restaurant without knowing that it's a social business. And for us it's a plus. That does not mean that we are not advertising as a social business. Of course we do. But on the other case, we want also to be as a business like another one, just a business. And it is the strength of the restaurant. You know probably that it's a difficult field, and restaurants, when the crisis came, for example, a lot of them made bankruptcy, and it was complicated for the company to survive. So these 11 years of experience shows that we are providing a good service. And at the end, the business objectives is, of course, the financial stability. So at the beginning, the partnership gave the first investment. I think I will be able to talk about the partnership later. And then the activity, of course, self-financed the work of the company, having in mind always that if we want to integrate more than two or three persons, we need extra support because it's extremely costly. So a support from ESF projects, it's the only way really to finance this the integration of the excluded, socially excluded people. And then, of course, social objectives. So even if it's an open company, even if people are living, our target group living in town, it's still a protected environment. Because as you said, we are giving not one chance, we are giving five chances. And we have, unfortunately, we have a target group which we have to motivate it from the beginning. We have to take them, bring them to Mano Guru, motivate them, and it's complicated. And then re-motivate them each day because their mood is going like this. And really, you have to be patient. So this also, the tolerance that the personnel of the mentors are developing towards the target group strengthens them. And this is clearly would be extremely different in a normal business, in a normal restaurant, without this social objective. So we have, of course, our main objective is to train those people and to provide the instruments for the and means for the individual development. We are providing few specialist aid, like and material aid also. We are trying to keep a friendly atmosphere, which is not easy. And we have also the social and cultural function of window to the city. Window to the city is our way of saying that a restaurant is an open place. It's not a factory. It's not a shop. It's an open place where people are coming. So it's good for our target group because they are learning to work with people, to talk to people, to solve the conflicts, because those people have a lot of psychological problems and it's not easy for them to go to people. And exactly the same thing is from the public, is the public has his the stereotypes about ex-drug addicts or about ex-prisoners. So coming to my guru and seeing those people working normally, being kind, and this also makes the society of the community of our clients more tolerant. So there is an exchange, and it's a restaurant. It's a good sector for integration of those target groups, which are very complicated to integrate into the labor market. So Mano Guru work method we have developed through as innovation or as methodologies for work when we were funded by ESF, a few work instruments that we are using in our each day life. It's of course a program destined to train project participants in workplace through mentorship. So we have developed those methodologies for cook, bartender and waiter professions. We have developed a motivation program how to work and have legal incomes, because as I told you, everything is motivation, and you cannot succeed without motivation, and those persons are not motivated. They are losing their motivation. Sometimes they are super enthusiastic. Sometimes they just they are not coming to work, and you have to deal with that. And of course, we have a special program for mentors and other personnel from the which are not from the target group. We also more or less have 50% of target group and 50% of just personnel. So we need also to motivate them. What we think is it's a very specific field. We are working with a very specific target group, but at the end, the model is universal and it can be applied in any other sector, economical sector. It can be also be applied to any other target group. As I think we see now, and it's also can be applied in any other region, and etc. So after 11 years, we have received about 400 participants, 80% successfully integrated into the society. So we have to know why I started by this distinction between rehabilitation and reintegration. Then people comes from rehabilitation, they succeed rate is 40%. And if a rehabilitation center is achieving 40% of successfully integrated people into the society, they are extremely happy. So we have 80%. That means that this really reinsertion phase gives a plus. And we have been recognized in, and we have received very nice acknowledgements, and of course it's Regio Stars in 2010, where Mano Guru was nominated one of the 6 best in Europe implemented social integration projects. In 2011, we participated to European Enterprise Awards, and we became the winner in the responsibility and integrating the entrepreneurship category. And we were winning in Lithuania, it's Open Roads, it's for structural projects in 2013 so recognized on European level twice and on national level. So I will skip the specificities of the work with the target group. The only thing that I wanted to say is that those persons who are coming from the deeply excluded, in a deep social exclusion situation, those people who are coming, they don't have one problem. They have all the problems, possible and imaginable. And so you cannot help them with one solution. You have to provide a complex aid. And when it comes to the reality, it's costly. That's why, for example, for us, the ESF support was very important. So you see, you have your clients, you have to fulfill your everything that you promised to them, and at the same time you have to think about your target group self-esteem, and it's not easy. So what's next? I would like to finish my presentation on that. We have a good experience. We improved our model, we theorized our model, it's sustainable. We think that we can be an initiative which can inspire other initiatives, and normally it's a model that can be easily transferable, and there is a multiplication effect that should happen. The multiplication effect is then you can transfer the model to other enterprises, organization, and other sectors. And what is interesting is that it has never been done. It has never happened. And we are astonished because we were not able to develop ourselves further. We still have one restaurant, that's it. But we worked on this, on the development, we worked on the diversification, on our will working in different sectors, etc., etc., but it hasn't worked. We, nobody was inspired, even if a lot of people are coming, etc., nobody from the public sector, no from the private sector was inspired. And I wanted to say it because it's interesting not only see the successful part, but also see the problematic part of the thing. So if you, you are inspired by this model, you can, you should know that after 11 years, we will not be able to develop ourselves. And we were thinking about a lot about social enterprises, which are still problematic in Lithuania because of the legislation. And we are trying to make some advocacy, but it's also still complicated. In Lithuania, social enterprises are more or less oriented towards disabled people, and then it's kind of monopoly. So for other target groups, it's complicated to enter into this category. So we are recognized as a social enterprise, but we don't have the status of social enterprise, unfortunately. So what is this, what is the social enterprise for us in this context that we are talking about? It's a social enterprise, it's an enterprise which should be transitive. So we are a transitive enterprise. That means that people are not coming to work for ages, for years and years. We are transitive because people are coming, we are training them, they are working there, and then we are passing them to the labor market. We are finding them a job, inserting them, and then we are going to catch others. So it necessarily should be transitive. Then it should be, of course, dedicated to the social purpose. And it should be specifically organized to that purpose and to specifically organized for this target group. This is very important. And the role of CSF, of course, we think that well, structural money shall have a structural goal. So for us, it's the role of ESF to develop an infrastructure on which we would be able, all of us, build social businesses, which is not the case yet in Lithuania, and I'm not sure about Latvia, but this is something to work with, because there are resources and there are possibilities, but we have to make a lot of advocacy for that. And the few last words, and I'm finishing, it's about social franchising. So you started, you just used the term. We have thinking about 5 years about social franchising, but there again, it was possible in Sweden, it was possible in France, it was possible in other countries, because ESF was behind, because ESF financed social franchising. It was a pipeline to finance, to multiply those initiatives which are successful, which show that they can work. And unfortunately, it's not still the case, but it would be extremely interesting to work on social franchising. It's just a way to pass your good experience to another business and to get out of that something. Why, as we say, why reinvent the wheel when you have the wheel and you can just use the thing, take it with the support of people who have developed their own initiatives and just replicate it. Yeah. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Aiste, so much. And now again, the question time.
Well, Aiste, thank you very much for your presentation. Actually, when I looked at your video presentation, I realized that I was in Mano Guru for several times, and I never thought that it is social enterprise, so good work, and keep the same line in the future. But I wanted to ask you a question. Actually, who is the risk taker, and what are the biggest risks in your job? Thank you.
So they, at the beginning, the enterprise, it was an idea of the mayor of the city. In 2009, or 2000, it was the mayor who came from somewhere, from Prague probably, with this idea. And it was a partnership set with the municipality of Vilnius, the addiction center of Vilnius, and a private company. So it's a private-public partnership. And they established together, as founders, they established the NGO with the purpose of opening a restaurant for ex-drug addicts rehabilitation in Vilnius. The municipality gave the premises. The private business gave the credit, because it was important from where I start. When you need a restaurant, you need the equipment, especially kitchen equipment, which costs, it is extremely costly. And as you know, for NGOs who are working in social field, for example, at that time it was not yet ESF money, but you know that ESF is financing soft investment, but not hard investment, and it's complicated to combine two at the same moment, to have the hard investment from ERDF type expenses and ESF type of expenses. So they were saved by this public-private partnership, because the private company decided to give the credit, and the credit was huge. It was 200 of thousands of euros. Yeah, 200. Yeah, exactly. So it's a lot of money, but they shared somehow the risk, and then they hired Reda. She became the director, and somehow she succeeded. So when I came, I'm an external consultant, and when I came to write the model and methodology, I was trying to put everything to theorize the how it works really, how we can replicate it and get out all the empirical things of the model. And at the end, I realized that this kind of small initiative works around a person who is really inspired by it. So if you don't have the manager who believes, who is the soul of the projects, the soul of the idea, and who believes in that, then you have to have a extremely strong founders who will maybe choose another manager. But anyway, working with people, it's about people too. So if you have no manager, if you have a manager who don't believe in social things, or if you have a manager who believes only in business things or only social things, it will not work. It's always also about persons. So it's not also about target group, but it's also about managers and executives and persons who are working in the project.
Okay, my question is a bit... my question is a bit more about, you mentioned these 400 people and 80% are successful, a bit more how and what kind of further jobs and professions they go to. Do you have some kind of statistics, and how many of them get some other profession during their work time in the enterprise, and how many switch to the same profession? Some information about that. Thank you.
Maybe not statistics, but information, yes, because at the end, those people are coming back to Mano Guru, and they know each other, and they talk, so we can keep records on what is happening in their lives. And there is a part who is working in the same field, so with the profession that we provided. There's another part who are going to further studies and a changing of profession, which is also good. Of course, there are, during the immigration times in Lithuania, there are a lot of young people who emigrated, but then we know that everything is okay for them. So it's really, it's those years that they are passing in Guru, it really gives this impulse. And what is important, somebody said that what is important is that this integration of extremely excluded people, it does not take 1 year. It does not take 2 years, it takes time. It need to be successful, it needs time. And unfortunately, it's very complicated sometimes to explain to our ESF agencies who are financing projects and asking you results after 6 months or results after 1 year. And unfortunately, if you are investing only for 1 year, this money will be lost. You have to, if you are investing, you have to invest the full thing, and then you give really the chances to the person to be reintegrated in the society. But they're marrying, they're creating families. There is a various, we don't keep really statistics, but it really opens different doors.
Well, this is somehow two questions, if I may. Well, 11 years you are on the ground. This is a quite long period for a restaurant, because an average business cycle of that type is 3 to 5 years, and then you have to change the. That certainly gives you. Yeah, the first question is what's the source of this sustainability? The other question goes out from the previous. You probably got the competitive edge towards the other operators in this field. And the question is, what's then the core competence?
So the core competence, I will start with the second question. The core competence, in fact, it's a kind of comparative advantage which is not based on the social, it's not based on the social business part. It's not based on the social image that we are selling. Yeah, definitely. Sorry for arrogance. But this is that was the idea, is to have a business which will really be good. And in Lithuania, as probably in all small market, if you are innovating on the market, on the business part, if you are innovating, you are immediately copied by others. So when they open the restaurant for salads, they have 63 kinds of salads, and then 23 kinds of desserts. So a huge menu. We're not playing on the menu of nine propositions. It's a huge menu, and they thought that they will copy it immediately. And all the city was talking about, we will create another salad bar, etc. 11 years and no salad bars in Vilnius. I don't know why. Maybe it's a miracle, and God is with us. And I'm not joking. No miracles? No, I believe in miracles. We should. So this is the difference. Then there are other things. For example, in Lithuania, to be a server, it's not a profession. It's a profession for, it's not a profession, it's an occupation for students. In France, you can have servers who was working in a restaurant for 30, 40 years. It does not exist in Lithuania. And it's extremely unprofessional. So what they want to achieve is also to give real professional skills. And because they have time, because they have those months funded by ESF, and because they are doing only that, training people, they can get this quality out of them. And it makes a difference. And so those two, the menu, the very good location also, because it's one of the main streets of Vilnius with big windows. It helps. Around you have banks, legal offices.
You have to talk in a mic.
It's, well, Because it's in the center of the business quarter of the old town, it helps because you have receptive clients. So they like the food, they like also the idea, and at the end they're extremely fidel. They are here. We have businessmen who have established the morning office in Mano Guru, who are coming to meet the clients. For years, we have clients who are coming with their laptops and working in the morning. And this is also very interesting because we have clients who just like us, and they are coming back and coming back.
I have a question. How long approximately do these persons work in Mano Guru, and how they decide to leave and to go to work to the other place? And maybe there is a risk that they don't want to leave.
Kiek laiko dirba Mano Guru vidutiniškai ir kada jie nusprendžia išeiti iš darbo, ar mes jūs išmetam, jeigu ateina laikas tam? Tai aš suprantu. Čia projektas. O kai jau pradeda dirbti pas mus? O tie, kurie lieka dirbti, kaip mes juos iškrapštom? So we two categories, the project participants and those who after the project are staying in the in-house and are becoming our employees, not all of them. So for those who are becoming our employees, we are bringing them to the real good level. So some of them are here because they are studying in parallel and they need this job to get another profession. Some of them are just becoming administrators or mentors, so they have a career inside.
You told that you provide also accommodation. How do you solve this problem? Do you rent flats?
Yeah, that was complicated. When it was eligible under ESF, it was the best period, and our success rates were the best when we were able to provide accommodation because it was eligible under ESF. And we just rent a big apartment, and we placed a social worker there. And they were sharing by two rooms and they were living. That was the model. Unfortunately, not each time when you have call for proposals, not each time the accommodation is eligible. So it's also, it's complicated when something is not eligible, but you need. And accommodation, definitely you need accommodation. It helps, it gives an added value to all other efforts that we are doing in the project.
And how many with previous drug addicts could live at the same time, could be in this training program?
Kiek viena projektinė grupė, kiek pas mus žmonių? Nuo 6 iki 12? It depends, because 11 years, it's a lot, it depends on the economic situation, but it goes from 6 to 24. It was one time it was 24 because, well, they were here and we had to take them on board.
Does it mean that you have the same number of staff members? You said half
we
and half clients.
We have 25 employees.
Oh, that means one staff member per one client.
Yeah. Usually the groups are from 6 to 12.
Thank you.
But among the employees, so this project groups, but among the employees, you have 50 to 50, more or less, the ex-drug addicts, ex-project participants, and just regular employees.
Aiste, would it be possible to run Mano Guru model purely on business terms without any extra funding? Because you said that the programs and individual programs are very costly. Would it be possible to do it on business terms only?
It would be possible if we if it will be acceptable to integrate one or two persons per year. So you don't have the critical size. It would be possible. Afterwards, as I told, it was no business development for reasons which are very difficult to identify, or if we could, we would be able to, yeah, three Mano Guru maybe would provide this financial basis to self-finance the social integration, but without extra support, and it's extremely complicated. Feasible, but complicated.
Do you receive some support from the state and the local authorities right now as well?
So this is the question. We have ESF project. It's okay. We're winning them, and we have this money only for social integration, and we're using Mano Guru as a platform for training and integration. That's okay. But without this one, as we don't have social enterprise status, we are not receiving any other support. So for me, what the idea is to say that for this kind of, this specific kind of enterprise that we have developed, there's no possibility to be financially viable on the market if you don't have municipal or governmental support for those activities which are related to integration. We don't need to support to our business activities. We need to just to have money for social worker, extra social worker, just have money for psychologist. We are working with our mentors, so that's okay. We need the accommodation. And of course, if for example in a social and real social enterprise, they have subventions for the wages. We don't have that. So with this support, we could integrate people without ESF.
Do you receive any donations from the society as well?
We have never applied really to that. No, we have never applied to it. It's possible the legal status of NGO permits it, but we have never really done it.
One more last question.
Could you tell a bit about this motivation program? How long does it take to motivate these people to work?
Motivacinė programa. Tai kiek trunka ir kaip organizuojama? Bet tai yra socialinio darbuotojo darbas. It's an instrument for the social worker. And each time, of course, it's a face-to-face work. So they it depends on the motivation of the person that it's concerned. And usually it goes along all the process of the staying in the project. So we are starting from motivation program, but then we are continuing in parallel the motivation till the end of the participation to the project. And but we can share if you are interested. Just give me your card and we can share the methodology.
So, as I don't see any hands up right now, then thank you,
Aiste,
so much.